Then they ask you, Reverend, do you know anything about why we put white sheets over our community? I said, I'm glad you asked, because I really do. In our culture, in African American history, we cannot afford those pretty communion trays. Neither did we have, amen, air conditions in our churches. Amen. And so on the Sundays when they would take communion, because there were no air conditions, flies would come in. I'm going to talk back to you here. And so what the old folk decided was they would cover up the communion to keep flies from getting on the wine and the bread. And you come to church on Sunday morning and don't have that white sheet over the communion, there's some folk that will think you died on the head. I ain't got no hip up in here. When it has nothing to do with the Bible, it's all about our tradition. We got air conditioners that we can set on 67 and still arguing about whether white sheep go, and the trays are covered now. Come on, talk that to me here. And in some of our congregations, it's already prepared. You get your cup and your bread at the same time. Word of God. Amen, amen. Amen, amen. Amen, amen. That made some of y'all mad, so let me go another direction. I see you looking at me. That's right. Boy and his wife got married, and when they got married, they went home, and the wife said, baby, I'm going to cook for you tonight. He said, what you going to cook? She said, I'm going to make us a ham, and some turnip greens, and go have a good meal. And so she got this ham out and got this big, hey man, roaster out. And when she got ready to put the ham in, and she cut the sides off the ham. And looked around and wondered what was up with that. And he said, well, I'm going to ask her when dinner's over. He said, babe, I saw when you got ready to cook, you put that ham inside the roaster, but you cut the sides off. What's up with that? Why did you do that? And she said, I don't know, I saw my mama do it. He said, well, mama, come over. I'm going to ask her about something. So mama came over some months later. He said, mama, let me ask you a question. I thought when your daughter was cooking me a ham that she cut the sides off, and I don't know why she did it. I asked her. She said she didn't know, but she saw you do it. Mama, why did you do it? She said, I don't know. I saw my mama do it. So when Big Mama came over later on, this couple months later, he said, Big Mama, let me ask you a question. Your granddaughter cooked ham, and when she got ready to cook the ham, we got this big roaster, but she cut the sides off. And I want to know, is there something special about it? Your daughter didn't know, so I'm asking you. She said, I don't know why they're doing it, but my roaster was so small that the ham wouldn't fit in. So I just cut the sides off. So that's a whole lot we do in church out of tradition, and we don't even know why we're doing it. Is on his way down to Damascus Road to eliminate what is a threat to his tradition. The text says that Saul gets knocked off his feet as he is nearing Damascus. I want to pause parenthetically right there and say somebody, isn't that how God interrupts our lives? When you're almost there, he says, not yet. When the prayer ought to be answered tomorrow, he says, not yet. Wish I had help in here. When you're on the verge of getting what you've been praying for, God says, not yet. Anybody here ever thought the blessing is tomorrow? I'll be okay in the morning. And the morning, it went from bad to worse, because God can interrupt our plans anytime he gets ready to, because he is sovereign and he is God. Amen, amen. God interrupted Saul's prayer as he was getting close to his destination. God is sovereign, and he can interrupt our lives anytime he gets ready to, because he is God. And Saul gets knocked off his beast, and he is now blind and without food and water for 3 days. Text says he has a season of handicap, a season of inabilities. Watch the text that says, and those that he led now have to lead him the rest of the way. I want to want to say something right there about those of y'all who are in leadership positions on your job and those who are in leadership positions in churches. Be careful how you treat folks. Text says Saul led them in the opening of Acts chapter 9, but in the middle of chapter 9, those that Saul led now have to lead him. Come here, come here, come here. Don't say who you won't need. Just thank God you haven't needed them yet. But your crowds have, it'll be a cold day. It'll get cold. I'll be dead in my grave. You'll die. Pride goes before destruction and a hardened spirit before a fall. Never say who you won't need. Just thank God you haven't needed them yet. That Saul led now have to lead him the rest of them. Be careful how you treat folks. Put your hand up in the air tonight. Be careful how you talk about folk on your way up. Because you may need those same people on your way back down. Amen, amen. Saul led them in Acts 9:1, but in the middle of the narrative, now those that he led have to lead him. Has interrupted the plan of Saul. And then there's a challenge in the text. While God is interrupting the life of Saul, at the same time, he's interrupting the life of Ananias. Amen, amen.
That's right.
Amen, amen. Saul's life is being interrupted on his way there. And Ananias' life is being interrupted while he's already there. Amen, amen. Look what it says tonight. Church folk, don't come to church needing a pity party like you the only one going through. I know this gonna hurt you, but when God thought about what test to come through, you wasn't the only candidate. The reality is there's somebody else going through worse than what you're going through. Some of y'all you don't wave your hands, you don't cry. We know when you've had a bad week, because that's the only Sunday when you want to act a fool in worship. But the rest of us know that every day is a day of thanksgiving. That God's been so good to us, every day he keeps blessing us. I don't need to be going through to give him praise. I enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and I enter into his courts with praise. I am thankful unto him, and I bless his name, because the God I serve is good. His mercy is everlasting. Hey, somebody, and his truth endures to all generations. I know this is old school, but we used to sing in the church. I woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. I'm walking and talking with my mind, and it stayed on Jesus. I'm singing and shouting with my mind. Stay. Thank you.